Welcome to the Geometric View, Season 2, Episode 7, where we cover the taxonomy of opposed spiral vortices, the blue whirl, the Doherty network, Indra's net, and how it has to do with casting a web of all creatures reflecting all creatures.
I'm your host, Buddy James. Strap in. Here we go.
Please support us on our Patreon link below. Thank you.
Email us, thegeometricview@gmail.com.
Welcome, welcome. Welcome, everyone. It is April 25th, 2020, and we are on episode
six
of The Geometric View. Today we have, it looks like the call is still going out. We have Chad Kushner, Brighton, Brian, Cosmic Sojourner, Michael McDuffie, Ramon Correga, Richard Blankenship, Michael Camaro, and Buddy James here, your host.
Nice.
All right, so we got 9 of 20 in the call, and people come and go during the call. Maximilian's unavailable. There's some other people still calling. Colin Tess. Tess is unavailable. All right, well, welcome, everybody. I've been busy the past half an hour running around getting stuff printed out to get our t-shirt for today. I just printed this out, which is going to be the Geometric View logo, and or at least one of our logos, and t-shirts. So this is a quick thing that I trace with pencil, transfer it onto my medium, etch it out, rub ink on it, put it onto materials like this. And you can see I printed, this was probably like 10 years ago, I printed these sweatpants, and they're in great condition. The print turns out organic, you know, but anyway, you can see that.
Those look fly.
Thank you. And it's comfortable too. I love to have comfortable clothing. So
those would make really good hoodies.
Yep. I have them printed on hoodies and different things, so I do it with other stuff so far, but for the Geometric View, I really want to up the game, and we can have suggested fabrics for really high-end materials, but you got to remember these are hand-printed and foot-stomped, like literally. I put my fists and my feet into it. I stomp the image onto the sweatshirt and the clothing, the apparel. So yeah, if you subscribe to my Patreon to support me and us, you will be receiving a t-shirt. So the t-shirts are not complete. They'll be done today. I'll probably have it on this episode, and I'll show it later on during the episode. But this is a little something I'm going to be kind of working on, maybe during the show in the background, maybe not, depending on what we get into today. We had a business-esque type of meeting yesterday. It was wonderful for all of us coming together and supporting each other. I'm going to put hundreds of dollars into all of us to invest in us. And buy things individually from each one of us, whether it be ice cream and all sorts of other fun things. And then we decided on a little mystery or Pandora's box that we're going to be offering, similar to, I guess, Michael Stevens and Vsauce. They have Curiosity Box. We will be having our own personal handmade items, and we will be offering those on the next episode of, or maybe the next season of the Geometric View. I'm trying to find the notes here from yesterday. I guess I don't need them. But what we did come down on deciding is I do essential oils, and when you become a Patreon supporter for a certain level, you will be given the curiosity box. You will be shipped the curiosity box if you become a Patreon supporter of a certain level. All of the logistics isn't done yet, so this is a pre-ad for you to look at some of the fun things that we have to offer. I'm going to be putting new bubble sculptures inside of these curiosity boxes, little tiny nice baby bubble sculptures that are new strange shapes and solid shapes that are unnamed and unknown until I pulled them out of the Doherty set and started sculpting them. So that's a couple things I'm going to be throwing in there. There's a bunch more cool things. I'm going to leave it. I do fractal branding, a bunch of other interesting stuff. We do jewelry. So these boxes are going to be like a $10 to $20 gift for each one of the a gift that's made from each one of the individuals here in this show. I'm going to start it. It's kind of like a white elephant gift. We all throw in a certain amount of money and we all get a gift back. That's most likely maybe more money than we threw in, but we'll see how it goes, because we all want to end up benefiting each other and supporting each other. So in order for us to grow stronger as a group and to start this, I'm going to put together these curiosity, or sounds I can't call nice. Them that. These geometry surprise boxes. And I already know what item, I already have my first six items out. So we're probably going to do this maybe once a year, maybe two times a year to start with. We probably don't want to do it quarterly, but we might want to do it quarterly. So, but first we have to organize it, and that takes a while, and that's why I'm starting it now. And I want to get all of our addresses, and we're going to ship each other the curiosity boxes, open the boxes, and have an unrevealing so that we have each one of the boxes. People like watching unrevealings for some reason, or unopenings, unboxings of things. So if we videotape ourselves unboxing these, then we'll also have that content to further our mission and our own material and our own goods and services that we have to offer. So the mic's open for anybody else to talk about ideas that they might have for the curiosity box or whatever.
So it'd be like a B-roll for the unveiling type thing?
Well, see, I could put an image of the Doherty set in one of them, you know, in the curiosity box. Then you'd have one, and then you could color it or make copies of it or do other things. But there's an indefinite, almost infinite amount of things you can do probably with the Doherty set.
Just thinking, I love the name of the curiosity box, but it's a total infinity box.
That's a good idea. What is it? Total infinity box?
Well, I was just saying it's a total infinity box, but yeah, I guess you could put it like that. Or I just like infinity box.
Really. Yeah. Sounds I like good. The word. That's a great contribution. We might have to just go with that, Michael. Infinity box. Anybody else like that idea or have any other ideas?
You might want to check on the name of that. I think I've seen an infinity box somewhere. And if they already have the rights to that name, then that's encroaching on IP.
We could just spell infinity a little different, or anything like small alteration.
Yeah, that's fair.
How do chest instead of a box?
A what?
Chest instead of a box. You know me, chestahedron.
Oh, a chest?
Like a little pyramid type.
Okay.
Box.
Now we're getting closer.
I see, then perhaps infinity chest is not.
What about tabernacle.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, we're getting closer now.
Some puzzle tetrahedron boxes.
Isotropic vector matrix. Okay, guys. So I don't really have I could honestly choose a myriad of different maps that I have, and we could just start jumping into it. And then I was also thinking, you know, I could just talk about a whole bunch of different things about the Doherty set today and just start opening it up more.
I mean, Michael said something about presenting his algorithm, which I have an interest in. I don't know if he's still interested in doing that, but his geometry is interesting to me, if he wants to give us a snapshot of what he's working on.
Michael Camaro?
Put me on the spot, man. we were talking about core algorithms and how they might relate to a higher collective geometric consciousness or something like that that day. But I think that's where we got off, right?
Yeah.
Cool. But yeah, we were just talking about algorithms, buddy, and I have this algorithm that I think is, you know, relatively close to zero. Condensing mass from 0 point.
Do you have images or somewhere where you can steer me in to find your work?
Yeah, this is fascinating. I'm really loving this.
I mean, I'm still working on my math, but it's just a blockchain, basically, you know, and in composition of information, so you can read it.
Like algorithm paths, Michael? Algorithm paths through the qubit to eliminate resistance, or?
I don't think there's any resistance at 0 point.
No, there is.
Actually, what you're creating is resistance, yes.
Conventional computing is where the resistance comes in and why your computer gets hot.
Right. What are your thoughts on it, for instance? Like, do you have a core algorithm that you use in everyday geometry?
Yeah. But again, it's forecast-based math, but what Roden and Powell are doing, it's just one leg of a three-legged stool is what they got. They just have a proportion and not the symmetry or scale component, which is what I'm trying to bring forward.
Yeah, probably the most I could direct you guys to my work, my math work, would probably be to just type the algorithm out. I mean, the beginning is fairly simplistic.
But it has to be simple to be true, in my perspective.
I'm sorry?
I like simplistic.
Yeah, it has to be simple to be true, but that doesn't mean that everyone's going to see it, right? Because you have to, you really have to have the proper perspective to be able to peer through the veil. Because that's what we're doing fundamentally. This is stuff that's outside the empirical system that will never be weighed, measured, or counted. It's essence that we're dealing with in number, the essence of number, not number as weigh, measure, count, right? It's numbers are much more than that. Numbers are more related to spin. Prime numbers are key.
Well said.
Sure. Indeed.
Yes, numbers exist because of distances, and numbers exist because they are frequencies and vibrations and counts of cycles that are leading off of sources like the sun. So, any source, yeah. That's where number comes from. Number is very fundamental, and we see that the mind of God, as many mathematicians and theorists say, God thinks in number, and the mind of God is in number. And if you look in many different religions, you'll see that that number is extremely prevalent throughout the scriptures that you're reading.
Yes. The Hebrews spend their entire lives reducing the Torah to number.
Now, you can take that concept and you can transform it to our understanding and our mind matrices and in our mind and in our inner gut and our knowing. So you can use geometry, number, numerology to bend and warp anybody's perception just as much as you can use the exponential curve to lie and get your way about anything. Statistics can destroy anybody's conversation or argument, and statistics can, and especially if you start playing with the exponential, because people are so almost afraid of the exponential. Mm-hmm. And we've talked about this in one of our episodes, a few episodes back, because all numbers that are expanding off of any systems become exponential in their entanglement and in their logarithmic waves and scalar waves that are leaving off of the system. And those waves that are hypersonic, supersonic, superluminal, subluminal are faster and slower than the speed of light. They can go, and their sound, it's sonic, and it's a sonosphere that the sun is. And the whole thing is most likely sonoluminescence, and the sun is cavitating, and it has bodies spiraling around it, and the cavitation is shearing off different elements. The whole thing is cavitating, and which is, I'm working on one of my first animated films, and I'm doing controlled cavitation first, because when you start to see how cavitation works, you can see how really, really tightly bound vortices can indeed transmute new elements just by spin out of itself. Oxygen and water itself can transmute new elements just by vorticity. So experiments in this kind of stuff is leading me in my understanding of the helical universe and everything being helical, helical antennas, helical induction, helical, our minds are helical, entanglement is helical, spooky action at a distance is helical, and there's helical threads and umbilical cords that are hierarchically nested as thoughts, and beings don't exist. Beings start to exist right at the corona of the sun, at the beginning of the Birkeland current of the idea of the creature, and they don't form successfully until they are cyclically bound and wound into the gut, into the utterances of the earth, into, through what we've been talking about, sonobiology. I'm kind of just doing a wrap up of some of the Doherty set, some of sonobiology, some of what we learned in the past episodes here, to lay down a further understanding of where I'm coming from with the Doherty network, understanding some of these micro vortices, these micro Z pinches. There's Z pinches or pinches on all scales that break individual plasmas up into other individual plasmas that people are actually praying to right now that exist outside in heaven. We already know that there's plasmas and plasma tails. Look at this. Magnetohydrodynamics is what we study here. And this is the geometry ultimately coming off of the sun that collapses into living creatures. And we hypothesize here at Geometric View that it's all sound. Now, when you look at the magnetosphere, and you look at these tails that come off and pinch and create other closed cavities of plasmoids, you get the magneto tail. These are angels out here that people are praying to. Where's these pinches? Anyway, they close and they open and they create completely closed loops of the resonance of these beings. We are sung into existence from the other creatures in hierarchical or in nested and sub-nested food chains. The food chains is what sing us into existence. The trees start singing, and this all comes from the sun, and we learned this inside of the episode called Sonobiology, Life Out of Sound. And these recursions are cyclical recursions that create bodies out here inside of waves that have actual geometries. These waves are called Whistler waves. And
awesome. So cosmic, I posted the algorithm that I was.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, I've been thinking of.
All right.
That is the halving and doubling circuit. So what I'm saying, I mean, I obviously know a lot more, but the whole development of phi, the Fibonacci sequence, is an analog to that. I'm thinking that, so in my model, I'm looking at the matrix kind of half. We're not living our birthright in this squaring the circle, cubing the sphere business related to this hack, and I'm thinking that even phi is how it was done through the seven days of the week in general. Sevenness is from the 15, because everything is centered in the middle through one, right? The one is in the middle, so it's seven on each side of one, just like Walter Russell did. Four on each side of one. Yeah, it's, definitely we need to compare notes.
Okay, so this is what you just pulled up, Michael, right?
Yeah.
0, 0, 1, 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, 64. This is quaternion geometry, and it's how the baryonic matter expresses itself in division in sexed pairs, like babies. Cellular division, cellularly, we unfold according to that matrix that you're showing here.
So that would be a decent core algorithm, because I mean, exponentially, as it goes on exponentially, you could encompass infinite
everything. Life. Everything is inside of this algorithm. This is the base fundamental frequency. This is what I call the base fundamental filament. I will show you the filament in the geometry of the numbers that you just shown here, in a filament. When a filament compresses itself off of a source, the grandparent, number one most crucial that all other organisms must go through, is this fundamental that you showed here, 1, 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, 64, 128.
Don't forget 0, 0, because that's the void.
Yes. It starts with 0.
I just put in, buddy, because this is fundamental to the doubling and halving. The Tufti couple is the yin-yang. It's everything with doubling and halving. And it's the center of what I'm working at that really drives that. that octave and having doubled.
Yes, that is what we can reference as a geometric frame called the A3 lattice. What you just showed is the A3 lattice.
That's so cool. Thank you guys for the feedback, like for real.
Yeah. Well, this is what we talk about constantly. This is literally what the fundamental that you showed there is the fundamental in the Doherty set, and I can show the geometry of it here in a moment.
There, man, I see it. It's just in a different form.
Oh, it's in that one and all other ones. And I'll show you how all of them nest into each other inside of a food chain, and they're all dependent on each other. This is where we get sonobiology. We get creatures out of sound through the nesting of these quaternion filaments. This is a quaternion.
Inside a vacuum, I believe.
I don't think there is a vacuum, and I stay away from using ZPE, zero point energy, zero point physics, zero point vacuum, just the terminology, because it turns some heads away. But there is clearly the vacuum is seething with energies and particles.
You could describe it as two spaces of positively charged negative ions, or I guess, I don't know. I don't know. That's cool.
I'm trying to think of where I have the image. But here, let me show you on Google Sheets here. I'm working with my friend. He were working on this together in tandem. I just shared the document yesterday. But this is the algorithm of the Doherty set in numbers, in numerics. I've been filling out this Google spreadsheet, and it shows the infinite exponentials
of
hop vibrations and hop bifurcations and twistors, because twistors are exponential. And twistors use the same mathematics as Maxwell's equations. So using twistors, you can explain the Doherty network simultaneously. You can explain the whole field of the universe, which is what Roger Penrose was trying to do with twister theory, which is his greatest, his greatest theory right now. And when you study it, then you start to see these. Why isn't this opening? Good Lord, man! I clicked on it fucking four times. Stupid information crap. So here's the A3 lattice, and you double it. Well, where's the A3 lattice? It's the square. It's the geometry of Walter Russell's squaring the cube, like Cosmic Sojourner was talking about. And if this article ever opens, well, that's what I get for sharing my document with a freaking Google person yesterday. Now I can't open it. The whole world has it. Okay. No, I don't want to take it to her. I want to see my work, damn it. Yeah, you better reload. Anyway. Maybe that'll finally load one day. I was working on it in here.
I think everyone should have access to that algorithm just as a baseline foundation for comprehending, you know.
Yeah, indeed. I came up with it, and I'm releasing it through the universe game. So the universe game is going to be a game that everybody sits down and plays, and they don't know why they're playing it, like Sudoku. They just sit there or crossword puzzles. They just do it, but it actually starts to describe and unload and decode the information in the universe and in the Doherty networks.
Yeah.
So I'm hoping for that to be out this year. I might wait till next year because we're taking a pause this year on everything.
You might be able to make some money off of that just with the information mining.
No spreadsheets, huh? Wow. I guess they stole my information and gave me nothing. Maybe if I go inside it. No spreadsheets. Fucking bitches. Anyway. Okay, so I guess apparently we're not supposed to see it right now. I shared the information before, and I also show the chart on my presentation at the University of Science and Philosophy. So if you guys are interested in seeing the chart, the numbers are there. And what it is every single filament, every single number has a code, and they're nested inside of dual toruses all the way down inward, outward, that are radiant and radiating and dilating. So not only is, and the perturbations inside of the ether of light is the radiating or dilating of these toroids inside of the toroidal field. I could pull up some images. It'd be easier. Maybe I got something in here. Oh, that one's interesting. Ooh. Very colada. Polyglotta. Oh, lightning. Okay, so I hope I can find another chart here. Okay, we can describe it using this. See how this circle right here on the outside of this this embryonic looking fetus, as because that's what sets up fetuses and fetal development, is this geometry. It's the same geometry. So this is one and this is zero. Zero is here. Here's one. And that's because it's the first one off of the center, one. It's the outside shell, the outside of every Birkeland current. And this has to do with sheath dynamics and building layers, like double layers of nested plasma. There always is a layer on the outside, whether it's an energy layer, it's a magnetosphere. There's a spheres out here. And when you have multiple spheres around each other, it creates current and circuits start to create. That's what all planets and planetoids have. They have circles inside, or spheres inside of spheres inside of spheres, whatever kind of layers they are, and then an atmosphere, and then a ionosphere, and they all put pressures on each other, and they build up pressure. And but anyway, I digress. So here's the second sphere off, right in the center. So it goes one, two are nested inside of each other, four, this is the fourth sphere off, one, two, three, four. Four off is nested right out here. Then it goes eight. This is the eighth sphere off of the center. And then it goes 16 inside there, but they all nest and create these double layers that is what's creating shells, and how shells unfold gyroscopically, how DNA unfolds gyroscopically. But this is just the first filament. So there's an infinite amount of filaments that come off of this, but this is the first filament, the fundamental filament, that all other filaments are connected to in one way or another.
Awesome. And I'm seeing that this is exactly what I'm working on in terms of yin-yang is what's spinning that out from center. And do you look into epicycles at all in terms of astrophysics? In terms of these circles being connected through their centers and...
Prime number. Yeah. Look at this image. Speaking of epicycles, look at this image. Okay. Now, we're what? The third rock from the sun? One, two, three. And every single one of the rocks or planets are exactly a certain size so as to be the ratio of the sun to the moon during eclipses and things like that, you know, the ratio of the pyramids to the size of the earth to the moon, those kind of weird anomalies that don't make sense. It's because it forces itself, the spheres force themselves to condense into points along the grid that are nodes, nodal points along the grid. And these nodal points are all dependent on how the charge gets dispersed from the system. Here's the sun, and you can see there's literally helical entanglement right here. And that's what keeps the spheres in their place along the solar ecliptic, the galactic ecliptic. This could very well be similar to how planets stay in alignment. And there's these tenuity from the strands here that you can see that are existent. And so there's not only this outside connection to the corona, but there's this inside connection that they're dependent on each other's size, mass, and shapes to form. They wouldn't have formed any other way. You know, this is a Bessel function, and Dr. Donald Scott's model of a Birkeland current shows this exact thing, and shows the planetary spaces in alignment to be congruent with his model of a Birkeland current that he got from Lindquist. Lindquist is another scientist that did the numbers that show exactly where the planets line, and guess what? It's exactly the size, diameter, per ratio of the Doherty network, because it has to be, because all things falling off of the sun are inverse square, inverse cube law. And all of these droplets, like Indra's net, are little tiny, just tiny little spaces that we call planets that are gigantic in our system. And you can see it scaled down here, not to actual size, but just so you can get the idea. And you can see the huge energetic currents from a gaseous giant like Jupiter. But their Birkeland currents would intermingle with our Birkeland currents every time we cross their paths, which is astrology. And they start talking about how planets affect us, which is all true. And if Heather was here to explain more of that, I'm sure she would be on the mic right now. So you see where I'm coming from there?
Totally. Yeah, it makes it.
Yeah, it's fascinating. Your analogy with Indra's net is exactly correct.
Yes, and these are condensates. We are a condensate inside of this system. So as with all the planets are and everything else, and all living beings are, is anode tufts. Check this out. This is what living creatures are, I think. Anyway, I propose.
It's very humble. It's very humble.
Well, thank you. These come from images that I've learned from actually Jacob Gable's work in anode tufts. He is an experimentalist friend of ours, and he builds vacuum tubes and puts different gases inside of them. Jacob Gable. But he does really good experiments inside of his was it Jacob Gable or was it David Brown. David Brown. Okay. Krypton. Okay. This is what we've been trying to find. There's Krypton. There's Krypton anode tufts and Krypton in a vacuum. Okay. We'll get it, guys. We'll get it here. But when we do get it, this will help us, I think, all understand how we spiral along the surface of the Earth as efficient energy distribution, eating, consuming, dying, and making room for the next. All it is just spinning the vortexture of creatures. So let's do Krypton in a vacuum.
You think the energy has memory? Like, that's why people think they, reincarnate?
Some people believe in reincarnation.
Do you think you get the energy that's used to, that we capacitate, you know, in order to function, like, has memory?
Absolutely. I think it's your personality. Identity makes it. Which is a mathematical thing.
They're part and parcel of the same thing. Me expressing myself as a living transformational art piece is the art piece itself. Same with our group. This is part of all of us together, and it's a piece of each one of us, and the group wouldn't be the group had it not been for all of our souls being here. It has its own identity.
That's why I say we are, we're each piece of the puzzle, and we're putting the puzzle together for revolution, right? And forming the boundaries of that puzzle. And we each have a piece unique in this puzzle. And we're here to find out what that is.
Yeah. Definitely. We're here to complete a universal grid for more expansion and just connect.
I'm glad you said that. Because when you were asking if energy holds memory, what you just said about the grid and the expansion of consciousness through the grid, I believe that that is where memory is held through energy. Because energy is timeless, it cannot be created nor destroyed. And very similar to water and how water holds energy to it, there's a fluid of energy that is fractal based in nature. But like you, your body, is your memories held in your brains? Is it held in your bones? Is it held in your muscle? Like, where are your memories? And through modern science, we can identify, you know, these are certain receptors and these are certain areas that light up when you remember something. But like we were talking about yesterday, the body being a transceiver, transmission and receiving aspect to it. Mm-hmm. I believe that your memories are held in your field around you and through your bones, through your antennas, you are able to download and essentially pull what is innate to your field.
Yeah.
I have kind of an idea about what memory is. I liken it to the record player, the vinyl record, the idea. And as a child, I remember holding records and looking at them, and trying to imagine how these tiny lines on this piece of plastic, could make a sound, could make a song, and could make music, and to me, it was a fascinating idea. And so just taking that simple idea and applying it to the universe, memory is held in matter. The music on a record is just bumps, they're waves. The needle replays the sequence and cadence and intensity and tone of the wave that's embedded in the vinyl on the record. We can embed memory in anything. I think memory is, we know that memory is embedded in water. Anything that whole.
You blacked out a little bit.
Consistent expression of a wave throughout space and time, right? The wave can be read from many different perspectives, and each of the waves that we make every day is eternal in that those waves continue out into space forever.
Yes. Now,
the idea of drawing from those waves back to us is an interesting idea, and I and my thoughts on that are slightly are a little vague, to the extent that I believe that I personally am a conduit that receives waves as well as gives them out. I believe that I am.
So you feel like
I'm created like the sun, and that I'm also that conduit, or that vessel through which waves of energy travel through, and those waves are all encoded with infinitesimal amounts of information.
You are more advanced than the sun in that you have intellect, that you can have, you have creative hyper advanced potentiality that has a penchant for showing everybody in the universe what is possible as a species. And that's why we have games like the Olympics, and why we push ourselves to the max so that we can show ourselves the endurance, and not to be braggadocio, but most of the time to prove it to ourselves in some aspects. But what I want to say where memory is I know exactly where it's at. It's inside your senses. Your memory is inside of your senses. It is how well you can accoust and acclimate yourself to life to the fullest with all of your senses at any given time, and be able to cry due to the shape of the smell of things. Sure, you can cry to a song. A good song will evoke you and to tears. But it's the heightened senses, when your senses are heightened to the max, that you remember most things. And then ultimately there's a point where your senses max out and they break and they enfold into themselves. And this is a natural reaction by our bodies so that we can avoid remembering abuse and trauma. So your senses go so far as to snap at a certain point, and then and you have a choice to where the breaking point is for all of your senses. You can expand your ears and hear infinity if you choose to. You can hear all sorts of weird things. Same with, you can expand your eyes, and your eyes need practice to see. And that's partially the whole purpose of trees, is to acute your vision so you can see micro details from far away. If the trees weren't there, who knows if our eyes would have adjusted to even be aware or care of things like that. Then you move to all your other extrasensory organelles that are outside of your body, like your plasma field, your sense of awareness, your sense of belonging, your sense of discovery, your sense. All these senses are so deep, we all forget that we have them most of the time. I live my philosophy by something called sense therapy that I started years ago, the month before my daughter was born, or in utero. And it's quite transformative, but it has to do with always changing and adapting to change. Because if you master change, then you master the universe. And mastering the universe is mastering yourself. And understanding change is what you're going to do. Your body's going to always be doing it. And everything else around you is going to be doing it. So I think memories are definitely somewhere tied in heightened senses, and the ability to be excited and excitable, interested, thus being an interesting person.
Hey, buddy.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I totally agree with, like, pretty much everything you're saying. And, I mean, our bodies, for instance, are the our electromagnetic fields, I mean, actually predict what's going to happen before it happens based on, topological static energy just kind of interacting with it. Really makes you think.
So here, can I play this this video here? Yes. Okay, check this out. Okay, this is what I think we are. We are nothing but charge coming in from the sun. Okay, charge coming out from the sun, in and out, because you can't have out within without in, always. The two never separate. You can't have, and there's no ups and downs or lefts and rights in the universe. There's only ins and outs. And I think that will help us understand things easier. So ins and outs would be like the ins and outs of the helix or the toroid. And then there's ins and outs on that. So
versus center and circumference.
What's that?
The ins and outs of center and circumference.
Yeah, so I think that would work.
I do. And the one having and doubling.
Or inner space and outer space having, or counter space, inner space and counter space.
I'm just trying to put it in geometric terms.
There's
only the center and the circumference, right? In here, terms of side outside.
Yes. The inside is always hollow, and the outside is always every single time an odd number. There is a difference between even and odd numbers. Every single odd number coming off of the sun is the outside of a Birkeland current, which is the charge layer on the outside that we don't see, and it's the invisible aspect of the charge that's building up the next layer on the inside. We are the subsequent layers on the inside. Every inside of a torus is always an even number. Always.
And that's why 5 is the inside of 1, 2, 3, 4.
5 is an odd number, so 5 is on the outside. It's not an inside number.
What I mean is it's like the, it's where the circle ends and begins.
Yeah, it all has to do with the radial distance from source with equal radial radion distances from source. So 1/r. Yeah, so 1/r, which is a simple, very simple simplex formula. This is the Doherty set is a super geometry, and it's a simplex. So the simplex super geometry of it is also scale symmetric. And helical, it is a geometry that ascribes to scale symmetry. So on all rotations of the system.
And is that what you see that you attain that through the scale?
What's that?
U or Z in terms of the law of them?
I don't know if I heard you correctly.
Yeah. How do you proportionalize the scale in terms of growth and decay?
It's the cube within a cube. Growth and decay happens along the fulcrum. All growth and decay and all matter and all subsequent particles are zitter be wagong, titter be weighing right along which is a German name. For trembling motion is a predicted rapid oscillatory motion of elementary particles that obey relativistic wave equations at the very, very center of these tubes is this. And these are the individual particles that are happening along here that are populated. That's why when you get to zero or near absolute zero, you get more and more particles. More and more particles show up along the fulcrum here and populate what is rotationally azimuthal Birkeland currents that are wraparound currents and field-aligned currents that are field-aligned in a straight line. This is showing you that it can be wraparound and straight line and that they're the exact same channel. And they can, that shows how plasma in nebular stellar clouds can have what are called there's a name for it, stellar jets, for lack of a better term.
Ionic
mass coronal ejection.
No, Herbig Harrow objects. Herbig.
I was not even close to that.
I know, right?
Never would have guessed.
I know. It's one of those, like, what the fuck? Yeah, okay.
There are a few of those that are just wonderful.
These are Herbig Harrow objects, and Doherty explains it perfectly with electric universe geometry and the simple geometry of Birkeland currents. Donald Scott expresses and shows us. These are hundreds of thousands of light years long of just beams that nothing in theoretical physics or astrophysics can explain. Herbig Harrow objects, which are anomalies in the sky. So you learn a lot by studying the anomalies, the breaks in the symmetry, the breaks in the system that are different. Double-bladed lightsaber that extends for hundreds of billions of billion. Oh, stars form on filaments. Look at that. So you see the stars and the new galaxy formations along that filament. That's a Birkeland current.
What this reminds me of?
What's that?
Photon belt.
I don't know if anybody has ever like looked into the actual science of how nylon thread is made, but this reminds me of a lot of nylon thread, but like cosmic. It's I don't know. I have a thing for spiders and like other insects, and so like cosmic threads are really fascinating to me.
Cosmic threads are definitely Birkeland currents. And look, this happens on Earth too. It's a phenomena. Well, that's a little different, of course. But here, light pillars, this is a natural weather phenomena that happens. And it pulls the light and stretches it into the atmosphere because it's like the right conditions, you know. Really cool. Formation of sun pillars.
I think I read an article recently about spiders using electricity.
Mm-hmm.
Somehow, that's a recent kind of a...
Yeah, so they use electric fields to sail. Their glucose-based thread is very electrically conductive. And then, obviously, we can add carbon nanotubes to it, but... essentially what they do is they make a little parasail for themselves, and it partially goes off of wind, because you'll get those wind currents that'll catch the web, and then you'll also get electric charge. So if they come into contact with electric field, the way that the field is being carried, it's like an antenna almost, with the way the web is weaved, and it'll catch that and just sail off of electrons. It's really fascinating and quite beautiful.
Mm-hmm. And this is probably sort of similar to some of the electric field that's taking and spinning these webs, or pulling the charge off of the oscillating string.
Yeah, because it's a charge differential that allows the movement to happen.
So this is what I was talking about earlier at the beginning of the episode, is whistler waves that you can hear that are coming off of the Van Allen belts of the Earth. The Van Allen belts are what I propose is the scaffolding for life to come into existence, pine trees to pull themselves out of the memory of the Akashic.
Wait, so, what is this called again?
This is called a helicon wave. Look at this, dude. These are Whistler waves, and this comes from an episode that we stumbled on by PBS that talks about the sound of the Northern Lights. And the Northern Lights make a sound, and they sound just like whales.
Yeah, wolf. I've heard it.
Yeah, and so I knew exactly what they were. I intuited that everything, including pine trees, starts off of these scaffolding waves. It uses these waves as a scaffolding system to pull or extricate matter into existence and the memory of the seeds. So the memory, the idea is there first, but it's on the outside of the ambrosia of the Van Allen belts. This is all completely my own theory. Once I heard them, I was like, that's what's going on. So then I did my own research. I got deeper and deeper into it. And this is what's happening with the Doherty set, because I started drawing these. I started seeing helicon waves. Everything in the Doherty set is helicon waves.
And so they're alternating direction.
Yep, and they're creating. Hang on one second. They're creating the constructive and destructive interference patterns for us to come into existence along these cylindrical pillars, and they cavitate naturally into cylinders. So this is happening on the sub. This is happening on the sub level of what's going on, and they refer to it as Zidubiwagung. Then you go to the helicon waves are actual real sound patterns that are condensed into these actual wave patterns, and they're really cool once you start to see how they move, and the absorption of these is what we realized is how I intuited it correctly, because the absorption of these is actually what pine trees look like. And I pulled that image up a little bit before, but let me see if I can write in absorption here. I'm a bad speller. So the pine trees pull themselves out of the this ether inside of these memory conduits, and this is the gut microbiome of Earth, ladies and gentlemen, because their actual sounds, the wolves control the direction of living creatures and living things based off of their howl. I mean, it chills you to the bone when you hear them howling. It makes you move from where you are to another place. They control nature in a hierarchical way where they're hearing these, they're hearing the Northern Lights, and they're responding to the Northern Lights and healing nature and controlling lightning strikes based off of their howls. This goes back to Ragnarok and the ancient druidic science of basically religion. They paired the two. Ragnarok is the god of lightning, like Thor, and Ragnarok has to do with werewolves and like wolves and things like that. So this all came to me out of intuition, and then I had a conversation with Heather, and she reassured me with all of these religious views having the same understanding. And it's very Native American kind of, if you look up wolves and the auroras. Now Heather showed me that there's a Odic runes, and the runes are actual language that has to do with every single tree has a aurora, a different kind of aurora in the atmosphere that they're attributed with, and the lines on the runes have to do with the language of the auroras and the trees. And it's like, what the fuck? So now I'm like, and I'm talking about all these recursive braiding of these quaternion filaments is what pulls matter into existence off of these Van Allen belts. That's following what I'm laying down. This is the ambrosia. This is the ambrosia of resonance right here. And when the wolves howl, they communicate with the north and the south pole, and they literally are communicating hypersonically with the whole earth. And the whales are doing the same thing. They can hear the yearning and the movements of some of this stuff. So that's just a little bit about that. Now, if I could introduce the idea of us being anode tops. Oh, here's the picture of the Whistler wave absorption, which is the pine tree, the same kind of, it's very similar to that anyway, because I couldn't find it. So, oh, and there's the Whistler waves. So they go like this and they... And it's not just Whistler waves.
Network.
Oh, it's very helical. Hell yeah. And it's...
Yeah, no, it's not mycelial.
Yeah.
It kind of reminds me of a mycelium network. Like,
yep.
You're mentioning... anyway. All right, so yeah, awesome.
It does, yeah. It goes right into the filaments of the microvisal networks of funguses and things like that. So here's this. I suppose that we are these dancing dots on the earth, and we are just charged dissipating, you know, doing our little dance. Trying to go in full screen here. There we go. Now watch how they move. They're all alive. They pair off. They sexually advance into 2, 3. They move around.
And this is Krypton in a vacuum tube?
Yeah.
The tube's being charged through a Slayer exciter, I would assume.
Yep. That or a Tesla coil.
Tesla coil, Slayer exciter, they're essentially the same
thing. Yeah. There's your...
Yeah, there's the radiant field and the corona discharge. Okay, so... How do I get one of these?
I have a good friend, Chris Barak, who owns Barracuda Glass. And...
Oh, so glass blows? Cool. Because I need a good glass blower for an experimental transformer I'm building.
Nice. Yeah.
I need a chamber also, a vacuum chamber. So that'd be awesome.
Barracuda Glass. Just wait, dude.
He's a very cool dude.
Oh, fuck yeah. I've had him on a couple times and interviewed him. Video.
What's your experiment going to be on? Faraday?
So, it's an experimental transformer using magnetohydrodynamics.
So, I'm working with using ferrofluid?
I was just thinking ferrofluid would be the way to go, yeah.
Essentially. It's more than that, but that's essentially it.
This guy...
He inspired me even more.
This guy puts multiple gases inside of bongs and different glasses.
Okay, he's one of these guys. I'm familiar with a couple other glass blowers that do this technique.
Yeah, it's incredible.
I've got some experiments for him then.
This is one of them anyway. This guy's crazy.
Does he know how magnetic fields affect those plasmoidal channels?
I have no idea. We could totally get him on the show.
I'd be curious to see what like a neodymium magnet next to it would look like.
Okay. That's just
yeah, we're discussing geometrically set up primer fields. I don't know if you're familiar with those.
Yeah, we were talking about primer fields the other day. They're pretty fantastic. It's I've learned how to model primer fields digitally. The problem is it gets really glitchy, and I'm not sure if it's exactly correct. But yeah, primer fields are ridiculous.
Do you use do you know if you use like just really high voltage to change the polarities to make the geometrical grids that the primer fields use?
I do not know, unfortunately. I'm sorry.
I think that's how they switch the polarities so that they can form a grid with these bowls. Kind of like the Vitruvian Man type thing he's got going on.
Are you talking about the primer fields as a grid themselves, like tessellating the primer
fields? Yes, they have a grid integrated in.
I've watched all three parts of primer fields multiple times a couple of years ago. It's been a while since I've actually seen them. Watching the first one the other day, and it reminded me of some projects I neglected.
Awesome.
I did some work with it. I'm trying to pull it up here. How he spells primer. Let me see if I can. Hashtag this. Oh no, but this is another person who did a video of he was inspired by my work and put this together. I've been trying to connect with him, but he speaks a different language, so we need a translator. Let's see what this is about here. Look at that. Pretty interesting. It looks like proton wave diffraction or electron wave diffraction of a.
Who is this person? They added me the other day.
Let's see. I know he did some work.
Their animation style is very similar to Brant Hinman and Living Duality. But they were sharing some of the work that I made the other day and made me smile. So,
yeah.
Shout out to this person.
Yep. I love what they're doing.
He also discovered a shape I discovered. Good. That polyhedra a little bit lower with the red and the blue.
Nice.
Yeah.
Yeah. Great minds think alike. We're all looking at the same thing from many different angles.
I'm fairly certain I did discover a new type of polyhedron. Just an individual one. I shared two the other day, but I'm pretty sure it's just one. Robert from robertlovespie.net. I asked him, and he said that he had it somewhere on his website. But he couldn't share a link with me, and I went looking for it, and I couldn't find it. The exact one. There's one close, but not exactly. And How does one confer whether a polyhedron or a new mathematical discovery is there? Like, you just send it to a bunch of geometers?
I would first... that's a great... question. Great question, because I've been doing this since 2003, and to confirm the work that I've been doing, I usually just go out there, and if I find other patterns that are similar, then it's a plus that there's a path. Then I study the path and I see, okay, so I'm not the first one, like you and I just did. All right, so then you study this guy, you study what's going on here, you study different things about where he's coming from, because as you see, this is the fruit of life that he has as central to his division here. The fruit of life is what the Doherty network is rotated two or four times, depending on where you're at inside of it and how you want, which elements you want to see. But the elements are a mirror image of their hierarchical images. That's why they're are hierarchical, lowerarchical. That's why they're you can't separate them, because they're one and of the same. That's why above, as above, so below. But what do you guys think about the Krypton? Whoa, what the Hayward and the elemental P? What do you guys think about the Krypton and us being like charge spiraling around on the earth, you know, trying to mate and then, you know, trying to live efficiently, mindfully, bodily, you know, there's so many types of martial arts. Like, you can't deny that we're all trying to find some beautiful ground on the path through this, whether you call it heaven or hell, because it's all based on perspective that we live in.
I like it. It's a cool video.
So yeah, you can see that we just scramble in, like scrambled eggs here. And then we just spiral around all of these other food chains. And we can see our influence as apex predators on all of the other creatures around us, because that's what apex predators do. They affect everything around them. Did you guys hear about all the pork processing plants shutting down in the United States indefinitely?
Did you say quark?
Yeah.
Yeah, but
like quarks and
I can still get a McRib though, right?
There's three main, three of the largest pork. Smithfield, a couple other ones closed, and probably they're saying indefinitely, like they're already doing bad before this happened, so they're done. So it's really hard apparently to produce pork. It's a lot more laborious than some other stuff, other types of meats and things. One step closer to weaning us off of meats. So look at this. This is the earth here in a hop vibration and the Van Allen belts. Look at that geometry, boys and girls. Damn. That's exactly what a tokamak reactor is, if you guys have heard of a tokamak reactor.
Yes. That was
all over. We're printing gold all over the world with these tokamak reactors. Not only tokamak, but sorry, the
German one.
But anyway, see the same geometry here? And this is nested dual toruses. And
there's a, where is it? Because it's got the twisting torus that holds the magnetic field of the charged particles.
Yeah.
I'm muted.
So you got a basic ring current. You have a ring current, toroidal magnetic field coils, and this is synchrotron radiation, basically. This is what synchrotron radiation is. And synchrotron radiation is what's at the center of the squatter man. at every single level and every single layer.
Oh, it's literally called the Stellarator. I'm sorry for interrupting.
Stellarator. Stellarator.
How many licks does it take to get to the center of the Squatterman?
How many licks? Or bite?
It's an old 60-year-old joke.
It's a television commercial.
The first option.
I think you always have to find what is lick.
Can people hear me?
I can hear you. You said the first option.
Yeah, go to all.
All.
And did you mean it's the first option?
That's my spelling for you. Oh, cool. Ooh. Oh, yeah. I put this over the Doherty set. It looks really cool. Because I just steal the image and then I transpose it right on the Doherty set. Yeah, I love this. And when we start talking about this, then we can start talking about nested hop vibrations. And you can see that we're trying to do biomimicry in pulling energy out of plasma or electricity. And how can we efficiently do that is the question. That's what's always been the question, is to try to create nuclear or plasma reactors to power the grids, because that's what we need. Love, we need that electricity. Here's a good one.
That's one of my long-term, short-term goals, is to build my hydrogen fusion reaction chamber. It's kind of a dream of mine.
Well, I'm working with a gentleman who has a high-performance plasma lab. And we've been corresponding for years now, working on different projects. And I know that he's particularly interested in recreating some of these plasmoids that I've discovered inside of the Doherty set that you see so prevalently everywhere in these. Here's the plasmoids that exist on like the so-called quote-unquote Planck level, which are just lenses, because Walter Russell calls it lenses when you get to the titterbeewagung, the zitterbeewagung, titterbeewing, whatever you, however it's correctly pronounced. You get lenses, which are just the spheres overlapping, and they create these plasmoids in different structures. Some of them are space plasmoids, some of them are time plasmoids, and they exist as donuts, different homeomorphisms or morphologies, cobordisms of donuts. And they're all moving in tubes. So the Doherty set is tubes, holes. Basically, I study holes, how they open and close, and what lives within them. And there's billions of things. And you can see how these are like exoskeletal. Put some legs on it, and then you got the insects. You got beetles. You got violins. You got harmonic sounds and aerodynamics.
It reminds me of jellyfish.
Mm-hmm. First like types of creatures on the planet. Here's a good view of the field-aligned current of a Birkeland current, which is the Bessel function, like a pond ripple. This is showing you the energetic currents within the layers. So the outer shell, always an odd number. Inner shells, always even numbers. This is super, super essential. And then from there, there is overlapping currents that create plasmoids like this, and wave. Have you guys heard of the blue whirl?
I have not, no. Or maybe, I'm not sure.
Okay, let me show you Let me show you the blue whirl. This is why I got peer reviewed and published in 2017 mathematically, because I figured out, which still there's just ridiculous amounts. I'm planning on doing sculptures and all sorts of different stuff based off of this that I have in mind, long-standing sculptures. Someone shared this with me. I don't even know who shared it because they said, oh, this looks like your work. We're just going to read it. It's a new flame that was discovered at University of Massachusetts.
It's funny because that looks like the dancing blue flame of zinc oxide vaporization. Actually, no, that doesn't. That's beautiful. But the blue color.
Yeah, the synchrotron radiation is the light blue that you see. The light blue that you see
flame
on the outside here. And it burns completely carbon-free emissions. 100%. All it is a condensed fire, pillar of fire. It's a pillar of fire condensed into a condensate. Into its most efficient form. So, how well something works depends on its shape. Shape is the most important ingredient in the fields and field dynamics and living systems.
That's why I think hydrogen is going to make the most efficient fuel for fusion eventually.
So
shape is cool.
It's important because a pillar of fire is what a pillar of fire, according to the Bible, is what guided us out of Egypt into the promised land. A pillar of fire during the night and a pillar of smoke during the day. So this is a condensate of that form, which is even more pure. And there's the geometry of it inside of the most fundamental. This is all three of these lines are carved off the first sphere from the center. So this is the most fundamental that you can get. And this is the taxonomy of opposed spiral vortices. What I call the taxonomy of opposed spiral vortices. You can see these voidance points right here that are scaling outward as the whole system always scales. This is what people forget to add to their geometry is dynamism. And you have to have an element of breath and motion. Otherwise, your geometry is stagnant. So
exactly. You know, that's, buddy, that what you just did there, where you showed the image. And then you showed the geometry, which is so thrilling to me because so often when I look at your models, all of the models that I see, which are amazing, I feel this urge to like, okay, now make it look organic, like make it look alive, like signify motion with curved lines. Geometry, we start by understanding the framework, the straight lines, but then when it's applied to the infinite possibility of nature, all those lines soften and curve and bend around each other. And so what you did here is you showed the structure of the plasma formation there and then showed the geometry behind it, which is perfect. But that connection between the two, like how this form is actually behaves in real time is as a sculptor, as a visual artist, is the crucial component to me because it's the translation from the perfect model to the applicable form.
Yes, a real world example of showing there's no bullshit going on here. This is the sandwiches of the cleavage of the pockets and cavities of wave conjugations. So when Terrence saw this, he freaked out and he showed me, he pulled up his phone and immediately scrolled to a sculpture and he sculpted that three-dimensionally already before. So that's what drew us together. I was like, what the fuck? And he showed me how to do bubble sculpting. And, you know, I'm not starstruck at all. Terrence is the shit. Like, he's really, really smart. He's been doing this for a long time. And he understands deeper understanding of three-dimensional art. He was already sculpting a transparent Birkeland current that was spiraling when I got there at his house. And I gave him an image, and he held the image up to the sculpture that he built, and it was identical. And I took a picture of it, and it was just like, it couldn't have been better. You know, I gave him a stained glass piece that I made, and then he had a sculpture at his house, and he wasn't going to pull it out. But then since it matched it, he pulled it out, and he's like, look at this. And I was like, holy shit. So there's a lot of new shapes that are already happening daily, like Chestahedron and Frank Chester. He came out with maybe one, maybe 10. I don't know how many new shapes, could be hundreds, but Terrence is coming out with so many new ones too. And me, I'm coming out with so many new ones too. So there's so many different people out there. You know, Chad's finding new shapes, and what you do is you just name it. So I call this the flame of life, and it's the blue whirl and the flame of life. And I have plans to sculpt it there at the university where it was discovered, and have an eternal flame that's always doing this there, because it would burn any fuel, carbon free emissions, so it'd be a clean flame. It's the idyllic image of the torch, a flame, an everlasting flame of Olympiad, you know, the Olympiad flame. So that's kind of the motion where I want to push this and take this into the 21st, 22nd, and 23rd centuries. This is the torch that's bled through my blood and gathered our group together. So you have synchrotron radiation that I was showing you on the sides. That happens at the wingtips. The wingtips is where the plasma gathers and the charge gathers, because charge pulls itself to the edges of things. Charge always pulls itself to the edges of things. And the corners, if you will. And I can show you an example of that. It's called St. Elmo's Fire. And St. Elmo's Fire is where charge, look at that. It's really hard to find anything nowadays. Okay. Science? Okay, there we go. St. Elmo's Fire is a weather phenomenon in which luminous plasma is created by a coronal discharge from a sharp or pointed object in a strong electromagnetic field or electric field in the atmosphere, such as those generated by thunderstorms or created by volcanic eruption, and they glow on the tips of masts. They've been seen many times on the tips of masts because the sea is electrically charged. So it charges the boat and it glows the tips. So that's St. Elmo's Fire. So you can see, if I could hop back into the dynamics here.
It's an amazing phenomenon.
Yeah, St. Elmo's Fire, which people think actually gargoyles used to glow on the buildings, and they used to light up, and different energy points on different churches and cathedrals, and also pyramids and Easter Island sculptures would glow, and the glowing is what would keep people away from the island. And we knew what kind of rocks to use that were glowing, and we'd use those and we'd sculpt with them, because the ionosphere was closer to Earth, and the rocks and the mountains were glowing, as they were talked about in ancient writings all throughout the Earth. And the rocks would sing aloud, and that's why in scripture they constantly talk about the Earth singing and making noises and the rocks singing, because they do. And you know, if you rub them together, you rub the right ones, you get other frequencies. But they used to actually make noises, and that's when dragons, plasma dragons, used to crawl around on the ground as just charge moving from one place to another. So if I could hop into this and talk about this, the taxonomy of opposed spiral vortices, then we'll go into Walter Russell and the importance of opposed spiral vortices. You'll see that the entire construction of all of nature is inside of this shape, and all of information. This in between each one of these is a wave. You can see the wave formation itself right there. That's just highlighting the spheres that are naturally there inside of the logarithm. So this would be six, this would be six, and this would be six. And this seventh sphere is, if that's six, same size one, kissing it right off, this would be, where does it kiss? Right here. Seven. Seven surrounds the void, the voidance point. So on the sixth, Earth was created, or supposedly on 6 days, and then God rested on the seventh. The seventh day is where rest and void is inside of, between each wave amplitude to wave crest. And those are pinch points between naturally existing spheres, as you can see. So that's what I was explaining, as Walter Russell says, the universe is lenses. It is a lenticular universe. And I have a Facebook group called Lenticular Universe. But these lenses are what I was talking about on the small scale. This, it's interference patterns based off of spheres that are radiating in different harmonies and resonances. You can see that the natural logarithm here sculpts this shape into existence. So I'll go and talk about how you can see this is one. This is the largest of them. There's no hierarchical larger opposed spiral vortice other than this is the life-giving vortex. This is the life-giving vortex, which means it is the gravitative vortex, which is negentropic. Okay, this is radiative, entropic, death vortice. Okay, it's larger, longer, and that's why we see and experience the death part of the spectrum of the wave. And we don't get to experience the generative pre wound up binding of the wave amplitude until it starts to exist at phi inside the system, and then it starts to degenerate from there. We experience it somewhere in this lens of life along here very briefly, and then we see the deteriorative, our senses pick up the deterioration, but we have precognition of what's going on because it exists already. So what we have is a system of the future and the past spiraling around the present. The present is always happening, and the future and past are always braiding around it. So they're all happening at the same time, on all scales, on all neural nets inside of individual helical systems. But we're all getting fed from the star systems ahead of us. There's star systems on the Birkeland current ahead of us. Now, if you look up Zitterbeewagung here, now look up Birkeland current. It's the exact, this is Don Scott's model of Birkeland current. Boom. Exact same thing. Charge on a larger scale, wrapping around in filaments. This was all discovered by the Norwegian physicist who proposed that the auroras were electric and they were connected to the sun. And everyone said he was insane and he killed himself because they ignored his findings, his discoveries.
God, isn't that the story, the tragic story of a genius? Everyone thinks you're crazy until you're dead, and then they're like, holy shit, you were right.
Yeah, so luckily they do. See, here's some plasma ropes, and here's kink instability. And kink instability is the braiding up of charge into a loop. And it goes, and it pops into a loop, and it becomes a plasmoid. And that's a system. And like a planet, planet popping into existence out of charge, a node along the force, and then accumulating. But anyway, this, we did some of this geometry in some of the previous episodes, but this episode's kind of like a rundown philosophy of a lot of different things, breaking it down into currently existing systems and showing that they exist. And not only do they exist, but they're proliferated inside of the Doherty network. And what does that mean? It means that, it means a lot of different things, but one thing it means is that this system constantly highlights over and over new discoveries that we find about the universe in very simple terms and very simple dynamics, spiral helical dynamics that are unfolding off of the sun in quaternion filaments. So, and the quaternion action happens, if this is the sixth one off, if this is the sixth one off, do you guys want to guess what the center of the filament is? Or the center of the next torus?
12?
Yes. Bingo. It doubles. So,
yeah, inside the next one. Say,
inside the next one.
It reminds me of my algorithm.
Yes, it is. It is the fundamental filament of the universe, but braided exponentially on every level, mm-hmm, into toroidal helical dynamics, which create the perturbations, the ether, electricity, electromagnetism, all the four fundamental forces into just a simple layout, a simple grid.
The basic variables.
So let me continue, if I could, about these opposing spiral vortices. So you'll notice that inside of this, the rule continues as generative and degenerative vortices, life and death vortices. Okay, so you have one. This is called the grandparent spiral. This is called the parent spiral. See the parent? Guess how many parents are inside of the grandparent? Two. There's two parents. See them? And they're identical, but they're heterodyning. They're nesting in phase conjugation, perfect golden ratio intervals. Which is important because that's the only that golden, that's the solution to progression. This is a progressive system. The solution to progression is the golden mean. The golden mean is the solution to move and have a dynamical system. And Dan Winter discovered that and talks about it a lot. And I'm thrilled to learn the correct electrical terminology from Dan Winter and what he's talking about often. So there's two parents, see? And the rule applies itself again. Here's the death vortice. The life vortice. And it's shorter than the death part of the vortice, even in the parent. Okay. Now, what would you call these spirals inside, or these opposing spiral vortices in here? Children. So you have parents and you have three children. One, two, three. Three children in here. Each child has a life vortice and a death vortice. And it works the same. This is shorter and this is longer. So it's harder to smell the roses than it is to see the thorns and the dead things. And we might get more excitement out of that. That's why the news preaches. But this is what I understand as the basic algorithm. And so from this point to this point, in between voidance centers, where the wave reversals, where do you think phi is? Right here. Right where they pinch, where the vortices come together in opposition. And this is the secret to all of it. It's not a yin-yang. It's not equal and opposites. It is a preponderance of, even though death seems larger and a larger part of the picture, the charge is actually equal, and there's an equal in thrust and an equal out thrust, but there's more power generated during this and no power. It reaches an amplitude, no power is required for things to die. There's no energy required to die, as Russell talks about. All the energy is in the gyroscopic generative life vortex, and then it hits this point and then it dies from there. And anyway, so there's one, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, 10, 11, 12 opposed spiral vortices with a central axis as the field aligned current. And that's the blue whirl, taxonomy of opposed spiral vortices. All right. You guys following?
Yeah.
Trying to.
Yeah, it's like a 369 type core algorithmic expansion, right?
Well, oh, I closed it out. There's
369, 12.
Three children, so. But it's 12 in the end. Three children, two parents, and a grandparent. six. So it's broken down with one to two to three.
It's pretty interesting. I like it. It's cool.
Diagonals of a cube.
I can't hear you. Can you speak up, please?
The faces and diagonals of the cube are the fundamental of where the two and the three come from. And it's in all of our physics, square root of two, square root of three.
It's hard to hear you. Maybe your microphone's not the best place.
No worries.
So this is like, I can show you a hop vibration, and this is like a hop vibration or a twistor. See that fundamental? And the earth works like that. And that's the fundamental fiber bundles of what you're talking about, Michael. About that number system, that basic.
Right.
This is also the heart that's, I'm working on a model right now, and I've actually got it fixed up right now. If you want to do a screen share.
Sure. But
it shows what the heart rhythm is, and it's based on the same exact geometry as all of these other twisters.
How grim.
Can you share it? Because yeah. Last time we shared the screen, it's not saved yet. You're working on it?
No, it is. It is ready.
Oh, yeah. If you could share it, it'd be better, because I can't see the screen for some reason lately. When you share it, I can't see anything. So it makes me like... I hate it because I want to comment and see it, you know?
All right. Well, let's give this a go and see if it works this time.
Let me stop sharing.
Can you see?
I could. Actually, a blank. Oh, yes, I can see it.
I can see.
I see it.
Yes.
And so this is an accurate reading of what a healthy heart rhythm looks like. In the green line right here, it shows what accurate rhythm of healthy heart measurement. And in the center, there's the heart with a toroidal field propagating outwards. And this toroidal field, instead of thinking of it as moving upward down and having a fluctuation in just that setting, you can think of it as a propagational field where there is the waveform is being carried along the torus, and then as soon as one of these circles ends, there's going to be another circle that continues this generative off of that.
So what inspired you for this design, you were saying?
It was the Dougherty set, actually.
Is it the logo, our logo of our group? Whoop, whoop.
Yeah, it was... your profile picture you had before the one you have now.
And it's so meaningful to me and so many other people. And Chad said he was having dreams about it after I was talking about it. Mm-hmm. So I chose to print it out, and I printed it out today, and I'm doing the correct measures to get a shirt done by the end of the day, if not a hoodie printed. So please tell us more about your model.
Well, you kind of think of the electric EKG field of your heart rhythm as a pond. And with each beat, it pushes out a ripple in the water.
Does it play yet? Does it beat and move?
No, I just have a solid structure here.
Okay, is it gonna pulsate?
I'm thinking about how to do that. It looks like a very complex thing to do.
Right. I might be able to help you, like a friend. who knows it really well. I could link you up with him.
I like how you did it.
Like, someone that's very familiar with heart rhythms or torus. Who is this friend of yours?
Are you working? Is it SketchUp that you're in?
Yeah.
Oh, I thought you were in
Blender.
Blender. My bad.
No.
Well, if you want, we can collaborate, and I can animate that for you.
It would look gorgeous, dude. And then to like some music, like of your choosing, of one of our friends or something. And then all of a sudden, you're making music videos for our electric or the geometric view album, you know, because you already got.
Yeah, in about 5 minutes, maybe 10, I should have the space whale thing done, and I'll share it with you guys. This has been more of a nightmare than I wanted it to be, but it's fucking awesome.
Nice. Oh, nice. Hell yeah. And I'm sorry to hear that it was a nightmare. The one that you're designing, our emblem?
No. That I haven't gotten to. Last night, I ended up spending till like 1 a.m. Diving into this space whale animation.
I want to see it.
It's nowhere complete, but... Oh, yeah. Well, in a minute. I'm actually finishing the last few frames of it.
Nice.
Just so that I can clean it up. This has been challenging on my... So this is kind of strange.
All right, Brighton, can I steal the screen back?
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah, Brighton, we can collaborate and I can help you animate that.
Really impressive if you could animate this, because there's a lot of components going on in this.
Yeah.
Oh. A waveform of a heart. Beautiful.
So I'm thinking about taking this image and showing the helicon waves of the Doherty set expanding and contracting throughout these as reverberations, and like wolves howling and controlling the lightning. This is all factual, you know, like they hear weird things and they start howling, and then it sets them off and they can't stop it. You know, it's just instinctual for them to do it. So that's why I'm like so hypersensitively focused on these helicon waves and how helicon waves braid into ideas of seeds. And even if the earth is promulgated with anything, the idea stays here from the sun outside of the earth in these Van Allen belts, which are radio belts, which are sounds. So the sound of us exists, you know, and it goes insular as microvisal networks during catastrophic events, when huge catastrophic events happen, and like a solar flare, a gigantic solar flare happens to pinch down on the earth and wipe everything out. The energies and memories in these nested layers that never get harmed, because they don't collapse all the layers, no matter what, even on the largest, maybe it could, you know, it could turn the planet into, you know, it could desolation, and probably has in the past. But these membranes, if I had access to my images in a better spot, I could show you the actual, what they look like. And these helicon waves, I'm really centered on this idea that they pull life into existence at the poles, and then through brine belts, some of the first beginning creatures continually condensate into hundreds of thousands of different shapes called diatoms and radiolaria that have the shapes of sonic impressions, and they're built out of glass. They're glass houses, you know. And everything is dependent. All of the food cycles are dependent on these. This is plankton. and they come from the glacial brine through glaciers out of cylindrical tubes. They're formed in cylindrical tubes, like everything else I'm talking about. But so you got radiolarians, and these geometries are clearly, they look like what I was showing earlier with my little plasmoids and the Doherty sets. All these shapes are apparent and in there. And then you go to diatoms. And this is all sonobiology, how you get living creatures out of sound, and microorganisms and bacteria and radiolaria, and then it sculpts the landscape for everything else to exist, and the shapes of everything else exists inside the net, Indra's net as well. So I just had to end it with that, end my explanation with that, just to smack that home and hit it home, because I think the microvisal networks hold the idea and the form deep in the earth, and the idea is also out here. So between the two of them, they're going to remember what goes on inside of living systems, and more living systems are going to come out of it, which is apparent. After every catastrophic cycle, there's a speciation cycle that comes right after it rapidly. And these are huge yuga cycles. You guys are familiar with yuga cycles. Yuga cycles.
Yes, I am familiar with yuga.
Epochs and eras of hundreds of thousands of years, and there are four total yugas, and they're long, huge universal cycles. And apparently Indra is a god of just one of the cycles, and then the Indras replace the Indras as the gods of heaven during each cycle. So even the gods are replaced, and it's all based off of a lot of probably reincarnation. But yeah, even God's reincarnated, the god of heaven. And if you look up Indra's net.
Honestly, Hinduism and the monotheistic polytheism and the fractal-based math that comes out of Hinduism is just absolutely, that's one of the experiences I was expressing yesterday, is just experiencing this to its fullest and not being able to explain it until I had the mathematics behind it.
Mm-hmm.
And this is what gives me belief that there's way more out there than anything we could ever conceptualize. Yep, Microvita, you were completely right.
So I've never seen a better explanation of the Doherty set than or the Doherty network than Indra's net. And then I studied Indra's net, and I'm like, oh, well, that's what I've been talking about. But it's helical and toroidal, not linear. But this linear progression exists because multiple scales of it, it is the same braiding pattern or similar braiding patterns as flowers, like this, which is just a circle repeating itself around a centriole or center. But anyway, so all creatures reflect all other creatures, and everything in nature, the sentinels of the forest tell everything what to do. Birds, sentinel birds. You got the okay. I didn't know a killdeer was a sentinel. sentinel species. Okay. These are birds that talk to other creatures in the forest, and even the trees listen. The trees, everything's sensitive to everything else. I mean, they're in the environment, and they all speak to each other. So this is a basis. This is just a basic that I like to go back on, is sentinels from the birds down, providing a larger fail safety net. Like, one species warns its friend, and it's warning to its friend, all the other caterpillars and everything else knows to hold still. And when it gets still in the forest, it gets really still. Like, all of a sudden, nothing, as if like even the worms know to stop crawling. So just want to put that out there. They're all connected deeply inside the net. Stellar jets, went through that. Birkeland currents, diatoms, helicon waves. The geometry of helicon waves is really what I'm interested in, and radio transmission, and probably HARP, all the HARP projects that they have been doing. Is all that what I'm talking about? I'd love to see some of that information. But yeah, there's so much information inside the sounds of the earth, and you can pick it up yourself. I have friends that have heard it in the forest. You can hear it in the forest with your naked ears, and you can also amplify it too, the amplifiers. So that's something that I want to do. I should probably do it like soon, because, you know, everything. Oh wait, no, I gotta go like probably into Canada. Could do it into Michigan, but you have to wait for a solar storm. All right, you guys have any questions, any comments? It's just kind of been an open path through me talking about some of the theories that I believe with sonobiology, sonotropism, electrosonic speciation, because this is what electrosonic speciation is. How was your guys' week?
So I'm uploading my YouTube right now. Is 100% upload, and now it's in the processing phase, so give me a second and I'll send you the link to that.
All right.
And I will be working on a couple things today in particular. Sojourner has an animation that I'm working on, and then before that, I've got to finish those 3D models I promised yesterday.
Take your time. Take your time. You don't have to.
Oh, I want to get them done today. I'm just trying to get as much as I can done in general.
Nice. Cool. Do you have a link? Do you have a link on your, did you upload the thing to Shapeways yet? Fish?
No, that's what I'm doing today. I'm actually rebuilding that one because it's kind of curved. I made some errors the first time I did it. So I was going to rebuild it and then drop it on there.
Okay.
I've got a couple of things I need to do today, but I am unsure why YouTube is being a pain in the ass right now, because this should be uploaded by now.
It could be the extra Skype being on. But yeah, don't be frustrated. Take your time. We got other questions, I'm sure, and other topics we could hop into before then. So I'm just so interested in these beautiful shapes and how they remind me of seeds, you know?
Seeds are a good way of putting them. So, like, talking about seeds, if it is a seed, how do you...
Well, it's definitely living glass creatures. And Heather and I were talking about how it's necessary, these are necessary in our soil, and they're all over in our soil, and how trees use these and turn the silica, the glass sculptures of these, into the tree's structure itself, the Birkeland current of a tree, which you can see a tree is a Birkeland current or a Bessel function, dendrochronology.
All right, buddy, it's up.
All right.
You guys are the first to see it beyond me.
Let me see here.
It's funny how my tile says CK on there, but on mine it says Faraday. Fascinating.
Yeah, maybe you have to put out a different image or something.
It's above your cursor.
That YouTube link. Up here. Right here?
Mm-hmm.
All right. Here we go. On to another little adventure.
I recommend both green and white if possible.
I'm going to pause it. What'd you ask?
I said full screen and HD would be preferable.
I'm going to pause it.
This goes a bit quick. Atlantean space whale.
All right. I'm going to full screen it.
Thank you.
Okay, is there sound?
No, not yet. That's the one component that I seem to always miss is the sound. So I'm trying to figure the best way to go about that next.
All right. Okay, here we go.
Ooh, it's a laggy bitch.
Oh, nice. Dude, fucking A. That's a fucking helicon wave. Yeah, buddy. Dude, that's what they do. These are ideas and memories inside of the, this is totally what I hypothesize is inside of the Van Allen belts. And it is, we already know it. It's just how to dial in the exactitude of the Dory set to creatures, which creature's which, you know, which idea is which that's talking up there or in there. Cause it's the gut microbiome of the earth, but also the outer is the inner.
Yeah.
Dude, that was beautiful.
Thank you. Man,
now we're talking. That's
close to 2 years worth of work.
Holy shit.
Bravo, sir.
Oh my gosh. Talk about getting me excited.
Yeah, right?
That's exactly what we've been talking about this whole episode.
I wanted to take this computer on a test drive, and so I did. And Space Whale's the first real application of that. Because now I know exactly what to do.
Yeah, okay, so, okay. The place to research those waves that you just showed me, and you can there's multiple ones, and they have nested multiple toroids around them as they spin too. But the Whistlers, they're called Whistler waves. Also, you might know this or might not, but they're Whistler waves, and that's the same thing as helicon waves. But there's a bunch of shit ton of other names for the other weird kind of other names that we hear by the other sounds. Some of them are chirps, some are warblers, some of them are whistlers, hisslers. So it'd be cool to see all those flying around in that image. You know, like you got the whale, but then you can follow it with like its babies. Because they are having babies up there, and you know, there's layers that charge builds up on these Van Allen belts, and it does exactly what we were showing with anode tufting. The anode tufting happens along these layers because there's charge differentials between them. So there's sheaths, there's double layer plasmas, so there's charge sparkling and electrically dancing across all these. And moving around as different plasmoids. You guys follow? And those little currents that are moving, just like the the xenon gas, xenon gas, or the that gas that we were shown inside the vacuum tube, that's happening out here too. And those are angels. These are plasma instabilities, and people can communicate with them, angels and or demons, and they exist out here, and they also exist in here because they're circuits. They're one and part of the circuit. So it also talks about angelic forms and angelic formation. You can get into that or get out of that, but you know, it's part of what's inside of all this. So yeah, hyper excited, hyper exciting. Cool. Anybody else have any show and tell?
Well, not really, but Faraday, thank you for sharing. It's really cool. My compliment.
Thank you.
Yeah, react
very much. Appreciate.
Yeah, I'll echo that. Can't wait to see what you're doing with the tetrahedron. That's incredible.
Yeah, so I figured out exactly the animation that you want, like we were talking about. Now I just have to do it. Now that this is out of my head, I can focus on these things today.
Space whale.
What was the software you used for that?
Blender.
You used Blender.
So may I ask, do you have a link to that so I can provide it to people who can follow your work and hire you?
a link to what?
Yeah,
say that again.
Like a personal page?
I don't know if you have a link to that or just your personal work. Where can people find you?
So my Instagram is infinite alchemy. So at infinite_alchemy.
Okay.
And that's usually where I put a lot of my stuff. My other Instagram is Faraday_infinity. And then the ice cream is VGAIN_vitality. And then what else? Facebook, my name is Chad Faraday on there. YouTube was Faraday's Infinity. And then I will be having my own personal page coming up here soon. I believe I'm having one with Living Duality, one with the Geometric View, and then I'm making a personal one as well.
Awesome. Okay. Please send us some links. This is the best way to do it. If you can, in the description here or in our links, I'll copy all of those and then I put them right in the description, right into the video, the YouTube video, so people can find your work.
Cool.
Awesome. On top of you auditorily telling us as well. Oh, look, this one looks like Trump. Or wait, no, that's a chick. Okay, so you guys familiar with queen bees?
Yes.
And queen bees.
I actually had to be on my arm.
Queen bees have, they build, the bees before it build a hive, a little house like this, and it looks like a morel mushroom. It's actually really interesting. Queen bee. Images. There's a name for it.
You ever heard Rudolf Steiner's position that we're getting a fifth chamber to our heart, like the honeybee has a five-chamber heart?
Five-chamber heart of a honeybee?
Yeah, so Rudolf Steiner says we're getting a fifth chamber to our heart.
Interesting.
Like the honeybee. The honeybee and the honeycomb are really, really deep esoterically in this model. I mean, I posted a GIF of it earlier that was from the 2016 Nobel Prize in Physics for topology, which I'm saying is the chirality in the field is vortex space map, the nested vortex, the vortex space map.
Yes.
But it's in the honeycomb.
Oh, nice. I'll pull up that image here in a second, but here... This is the queen's chambers. they build these queen chambers and lay queen eggs. These are all queens in here growing, incubating. And they look like morel mushrooms. So that's all I had to say. Anyway, and I love them. And I love bees and I love morels. Okay, it's an image in here.
Yeah, that's a GIF. You're going up. Ooh. That's important to the Dougherty set, that prime number thing.
Oh, yes, yes, very prime. Very important. I had a friend.
There you go.
Right here?
Yeah.
You know what makes these layers, what materials make this layers, right?
I'm looking at it all as pre-manifestation, that it all comes out of this through the Mobius. What you're looking at right there is 56. That ratio 56.
Okay. Tell us more.
Well, it's just it's a trochoid. I've pasted the images before in terms of just two gears. It's like the spirograph element of things, the epicycle, the cycles within cycles, Mayan calendar, the law of time. Inside of that thing, all this Mobius action I'm seeing is spheres rolling around spheres that are really, and where the two-thirds come in is the one-half and one-third of the Mobius that creates the spin of the electron and the doubling, the octave doubling with the one third. And that's the tritone, essentially, in Merrick's work.
Yes. Are you familiar with structured water?
Oh, yeah. Gerald Pollack. He's the man.
Yeah. This is how water exists inside of living systems.
Yes.
So all living systems have exactly what you're showing here, because if we're 70% water or something, but if you poke holes inside the body, we're not going to start seeing water come out. Where's the water? The water is existent inside of systems that are already accept. There's other systems in our body that are hydrophilic. And they absorb water and they love it, water loving, and they absorb water and it gyrates and dances inside of its system like this. Every living creature on the planet has this, and it gets really excited in the morning, every morning, right around 3-4 o'clock, because it's all anticipating the sun and the energy to become positively charged, because every night we become negatively charged, and during the day we become positively charged.
In two cycles, too.
Probably, maybe even four, who knows?
Well, no, it's gotta be four total, right? The four seasons, or that's the fractal of time. And the essence in time, or the seasons in the fourness, the one quarter, the 0.25.
Yeah.
Which is, it's profound.
Well, you could have a totally different system that's facing another system and have completely different laws. Like if we lived on the moon and the moon was facing another system, you wouldn't have four seasons. But you could live on the corona of some planets like that. That'd be interesting. Anyway, that's just hypothetical.
Everything I say is hypothetical. Everything.
It all is, isn't it? I mean, even the stuff that I say, that's a matter of fact. No, it's probably just hypothetical. There's no way to prove anything other than geometry. It's the best way to prove anything. But you can't prove anything.
Nope. That's why I'm here. Actually, it proves itself, right? That's what we're here to show, is that geometry speaks for itself. The truth speaks for itself. Well, you don't have to prove the truth. You just have to be receptive to see it.
Indeed. And
well said.
My first magazine that I did in school as a school project was, don't take my word for it. And I just showed my geometry as I was still building it, and did this pamphlet, and I took everybody else's words and showed it to my geometry. I didn't say anything. Mm-hmm. And that's still what I'm doing to this day. All you have to do is take currently existing sciences and put it and show that it exists in one paradigm. It's not a multiverse. It's a simple sheath of where, let me pull up an example of where I think that our mind field exists, if I could. Helical universe. Whoa. Helical university. Wait a minute. I'm going to the wrong school. Okay. This is where I suppose that our mind field exists, because, well, I mean, I did have been showing us how it exists inside of a recursive sound of the gut microbiome of the earth inside the Van Allen belts. But now I'm going to show us where it exists in the sun's periphery compared to everything else and our mind field. And it could be how I suppose it could be constantly growing, constantly advancing, changing, just like everything else. I'm sure you guys have heard of DJ Sadu and the helical universe model.
Love it.
So this is field, and I might be botching and saying the wrong word there, but I'm pretty sure I'm right. And that comes out in a flattened sandwich like the Doherty set, and then you have the center as the sun, and then you have all and you have all these little balls, and they exist as planets right on the Doherty set. You can see it, and it's a flat memory that comes out in charge, and it dissipates its charge efficiently into these planetoids that helicoid around it and are helical around it.
Love it.
So that shows like the memory and the idea field. Boom, there it is. It's that, but it's large. Very large. It's a massive memory field, a massive identity of a being.
Well, also, when you see this, do you see the other side of it in terms of the antiparticle side? But that's toroidal, right? And you're seeing the particle side of it, but it comes back into itself. That other side there is there energetically, right? Just like a gravitational vortex that. We see the top part of it, but energetically, that energy is feeding back into the top of it through that toroidal action.
Right there. Yep.
Yeah, so that's just the particle side of it, right? But the antiparticle side of it is still energetically in the geometry and number mirrored in that.
We have our muscles and our, did you see that image of the water coming down? Our muscles and our legs are helical and follow this exact flow. Your arms, your legs, you can see everything right here inside of this dance, everything. You can see your, I wish I knew my muscles better, but Chad Simo Morris pointed this out in his videos, and he showed that it's the helical, your fingertips, your toes, your legs, your arms are this, and we're conducting vortices. This is my part now, but he showed this image, but this is what, you know, we know this though, you know, Dan Winter talks about steering plasma tornadoes, but that's what we're doing with our voice. We're taking ideas and we're steering it and putting it out there and stirring up and cultivating new truths and new seeds, new systems, just by reverberating the system that's already there, reaffirming the system,
reconstituting.
Yes, it's a recursion. See it, do it. And
also that vortex has a heartbeat. I posted something that I create. There's a beat to these things too. It's not just static geometry, right? It's flowing.
Is it new or before?
Yeah, at the very bottom.
All right.
I mean, I posted it earlier, but I could stand and look at that thing for hours, you know, just studying it and watching it dance, because it dances.
Yep, and it is a dance.
You were telling me that. I've got one in my kitchen.
Yeah, I love yours too, Faraday, and I was blown away that you'd made one. I like these just because I love them because I made many of them, and they're all unique, right? They all have their own character, depending on the variables.
I noticed that I can mine to have certain vortex qualities.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I've made many mini desk sized ones. Maybe that's what I can do for the box thing. Make a replicatable desktop vortex generator. Because one thing that's fascinating about it, specifically the water in particular, the reason why I originally made mine was I was going to make a water refresher that had a tap in there, like a reservoir, but it oxygenated the water and destructed the memory patterns that are in the water themselves. So you'd have fresh, clean, alive water to drink, and you could bless it with whatever intention like that you want. Have you ever put your hand over the vortex itself, right at the mouth of it?
No.
So one thing that's fascinated about mine is whenever I'm really upset or like something really shitty's happened or I'm overwhelmed, I walk up to there, square my chest to the vortex itself, and then place my hand directly over top of it. And literally, I feel a gentle calming pull from my body through my hand into the vortex itself, like it's pulling the negative thought patterns and the negative energy directly out of my body, storing it in the water, and then gently deconstructing that into a neutral or positive based energy.
That's the magi. That's the magnetic force that you're explaining there. That's what it does.
It's very palatable almost. You feel it coming out of your bones. Like we were talking about that one time about bone breathing. It's like it's siphoning the negative energy straight from the bones.
Yeah, the bones are really important, considering the Eastern religions that, that do cremation as a standard practice and burying the bones versus cremating, because I plan on being cremated because I think that it, the bones retain your identity in this matrix after you, you leave. That yeah, got a lot of work to do on that, but the bones are very special in terms of piezoelectricity. And that, all this that we're talking about in my ontology is the piezoelectric flux of the vector equilibrium. And again, in the linear component, because Buddy's showing the curve component, right? But in that subspace, it, it's linear first in the real numbers. And the imaginary numbers combined are what really make all the curves. But the real part of it is behind all of this. So there are lines, but it's just, that's what all the sacred geometry is about, is the harmonics of geometry and the variable faces. And that's what I love about the chestahedron, again, is it opening up when it flowers like that. It's a variable geometry. So it's not a...
Is that what I'm looking at right now?
No.
No, that's Faraday's geometry. Well, no, I'm talking about the model that you're working on, Faraday, in terms of when it goes from the tetrahedral space to the chestahedron through pentagonal geometry. That flux is a variable geometry that goes through the octaves and the colors.
You know what it reminds, you know how you're talking about it being a force of energy? It reminds me of the propulsion system of a jellyfish. The way a jellyfish will elongate itself and then push the water out from inside its cavity. Right. That's how I feel the transformation between tetrahedron and chestahedron feels like when I imagine it.
Awesome. Yeah, it's like a vortex, right? It's like throwing, pushing, but throwing in vortex motion is what the heart is really doing. It's not really a pump, right? It's and Frank Chester does a wonderful job of speaking to all that in terms of the layers of the heart and that it's not a pump.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's definitely helical, that's for sure. Mm-hmm. You guys have seen the Helical Heart documentary.
Mm-hmm.
Have you?
Yeah.
Yeah, I figured we all have. Helical Heart documentary is great.
I was watching something on Mathologer, I think, was talking Fermat's last theorem. In terms of the helix, and I wanted to send that to Faraday, hiding behind the circle in terms of the perspective and dimensionally, because that one half again is in terms of Riemann hypothesis, it's all in that Vesca Pisces. That's really where the one half, where the zeros are, in Riemann hypothesis, is it's all geometric.
And you're talking about the 2C couple.
The 2C couples, yeah, it's just half of that, right? I'm talking about the yin yang is what really makes that, because that's simultaneously they're rolling and they're counter rolling against each other, but simultaneously they're expanding and contracting. So that's the doubling and halving octaves that are, it's all happening simultaneously through this horn torus motion. But again, through that Buddy's work, it's fractal, so it I see Buddy's work in terms of it's throwing that yin yang out, and as they're spinning out, they're going through that spout, that spiral, and it's three dimensional in around those planes that I showed you that are coincident with the edges of the chestahedron.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
but it's kind of throwing it all out, and the key is that it's bringing it back in simultaneously through hyperspace, right? The hypercube, hypersphere, hyperdodecahedron. Oh, that is, it's just turning everything inside out, and it's all really mirrors of 45 degrees. I think that only 45 degrees in terms of efficiency is real in unreal terms, right? But the rest is mirrors and rotation.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I'd say it's self-symmetrical, self-similar. Yes. Scale symmetric, you know, and yeah, we're all talking about this universe that we live in, and it's interesting that we you know, we can talk about it so comfortably and not be afraid of it or add fear mongering to any of it because it's unnecessary.
No, there's, we don't know enough to be afraid.
Well, yeah, people, they say, oh yeah, the biggest fear is fear of the unknown. The biggest fear is fear of the unknown. It's like, wait, aren't we all delving into the unknown every day here on this group? You know, like jumping face first into it. And it's really exciting to see all this information. This is Berkeland Currents right here. Physics.org.
When you push and the shadows push back, you're afraid. But the shadows pushing back is exactly where you learn. And you realize they're not actually shadows.
They're aspects of you.
Yep.
I say it's all through our choices.
When you talk about shadows, shadows are an interesting thing because shadows are used in a lot of different like spiritual traditions as a you know, so there's a lot of different interpretations of the idea, but for me, understanding is delineating between the light and the shadow. The space that's created, the line and the space that's created between, if you can visualize, between light and shadow is where information lies. That's, to me, that's where I get, that's my, that's where I data mine from. Like, it's always that, that subtle difference between the light and the dark. And this is especially applicable to sculpting, is when you create a shape, you create a shape where light hits at a certain angle, which creates a crease or a bulge or a shape. And that trying to see that line, as faint as it and as diffuse as it may be, is really, to me, where the truth of a thing is. I don't know, somehow it's an abstract idea, but it plays out in sculpture, so I think it's true.
So, I think it's all perspective in terms of, I think you've covered before, allegory of the cave, in terms of what's really going on here with shadows and perceptions.
Exactly.
Infinite number of ways to look at things.
Since we're talking about shadows and midnight and the light and dark, has anybody seen the Midnight Gospel yet?
No.
It's going to be your new favorite cartoon. Shut up. I guarantee it. That's a fact. Check this shit out. Okay, this is what's his name? Duncan Trussell, okay? Drew Pinsky and Phil Hendry, the guys who did, what's that other show? Happy Time or something like that? So there's another show that the animators do, but Duncan Trussell is a good friend of Joe Rogan, and I was watching it. I was binge watching it last night. And I don't know how much they have to offer here. Oh, here's 2 minutes. Here's 4 minutes. Oh my gosh. If anybody's has anything else to say, I want to close this episode on this. This is freaking amazing. And I think it's like, it's very much like our show because it's a podcast, but they animate the podcast.
And that is my dream. That is what I want to do. That's it. That's exactly what I
want to do. Okay, so watch this shit, dude. All right. I hope this is a good one. This might be the trailer. What is it? Hang on. I'm going to pause it. I'm going to say goodbye to everybody. It's been a great episode. I love the dynamic. Every time it's different with different people, it's good to get some other voices in today. This episode was wonderful.
Thank you.
All right. Here we go.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you, guys. And we'll catch you on the flip side. I'm going to hit play, and then at the end of it, we might do a little bit of talking because we it might just pull that out of us, but here we go. I'm going to open it up. Press play. Thank you for joining us. Season 2, Episode 7 of The Geometric View. See you next week. Okay, so they didn't do any talking. I want to try to get like a little bit of talking here on the episode. So we'll see if we can get one with talking. A little sampler. Oh, this is the official trailer again. You're gonna have to watch this. You're gonna have to watch the show. Sorry about that. It's really hard listening to this.
Okay, cut to commercial.
It's so good. So good. All right. That closes the episode. We will see you guys next weekend. Thank you all for being here. Views. Love is watching product. Love is watching production. Thank you for doing that. Music is by the acronym Beauty, the acronym BUD, and Abyssal Dionysus is the geometer. That's me and Brighton. Thanks for being here. Catch you next Saturday. Executive producer for The Geometric View is Buddy James Doherty. Thank you, Heather, Michael, Brighton, Tess,
Chad, Brian, and everybody else involved.
Thank you, Vladimir B. Ginsburg. Special thanks to Hartmut Mueller.
for the flow. The flow is keeping us together.
One voice. One choice. Nothing more. Nothing less. Here we go. Flex. 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 Your flow. Flex. Flow. Flex. Your flow. Here we go. Flex. Flex. Your flow. Your flow. Flex. Your flow.